one of the type of advanced labs. Are you able to see the screen and hear my voice correctly?
Yes,
okay. Okay, great. Okay. So yeah, so the last time we saw flat slabs. So today we are going to see rib slabs. So I'm sure you all know what rib slabs are. So again, it is the type of RC slab which some of the concrete in tension zone, which is at the lower side of the slab. You all know the behavior of beam and slab. The tension is at the bottom and compression is at the top level. So the tension zone, the concrete which is unutilized, actually speaking, so that we remove and replace it with hollow blocks, or maybe sometimes you leave it empty, as you can see in the image. So here the first image, you can see they have used lightweight blocks to fill up the void. So this reduction in volume of concrete in the tension zone, which is below the neutral axis, is based on assumption that the tensile strength of concrete is less, as we all know. Hence, all the tensile stress is taken by the reinforcement in tension zone. So what we do, the resulting construction is considerably lighter than what is required for the cross section. Is someone on mute? Hello. Okay. Whoever that is, can you mute? Okay. So this design and construction are useful in long span construction of floors. Let's say generally when we are creating RCC slabs in conventional method by RCC, we don't go generally beyond 5 meters, otherwise the beam depth might increase. So to reduce that, to go beyond that size, we are opting for this system, where the self-weight becomes excessive when compared to applied dead and imposed loads, thereby resulting in an economic method of construction. So that's why we opt for this system. Okay, so here are a few examples of this is Jimmy's presentation, which I'm showing you. So here you can see the span which they have been able to achieve. Of course, the module is different considering each project. It is not just that RCC frames, it is again modified a bit according to the design of the space. Okay, here as you can see, they're spaced very near to each other. Might not be required, but still looks like a big here again, same thing, modified according to get the light in one way rib slab. So the first type of this is one way rib slab, which in which, as you know, the long span RCC slab beam system that utilizes many narrow hollow shallow beams or ribs instead of widespread spaced deep beams. So instead of having like 600-700 mm thick beams, here we can opt for like 300-400 ribs, which gives us clear space below. Okay, thus here the span they can longer, of course, in one way slab with the same depth. So if we are using 500 mm, let's say we are using a 400 mm beam, and we are able to create 4 meter by 4 meter of the slab, support that slab. So with this, we can, with keeping the beam depth same, we can go beyond like 6 meters, 7 meters or so. Okay. So yeah, one way rib slabs can span up to 9 meters. Another thing, guys, always understand the, don't just go by the dimension which are mentioned, ki 9 meter, 2 meter exact, utna hi hona chahiye, but in proportion to the beam size, to the slab, rectangle proportion which it is going to have, keep that in mind and then think about ki what kind of slab you are going to design. Okay, when we are in practice, no one is going to tell you ki, okay, here a client is not going to tell you ki, here I want one way rib slab or maybe diagrid slab or two-way slab or anything. This decision is up to us. इट्स नॉट जस्ट द डिमेंशन बट ऑल्सो द सर्विसेज विच आर गोइंग टू बी कंसिडर्ड बिफोर डिसाइडिंग की विच स्लैब वी आर गोइंग टू ऑप्ट फॉर. सो सो फॉर सेइंग फॉर द वन वे रिब स्लैब एज यू नो इट कैन स्पैन अप टू 9 meters. द स्पैन कैन बी फर्दर इंक्रीज बाय पोस्ट टेंशनिंग अप टू 12 to 15 meters. दिस अगेन यू ऑल नो वॉट पोस्ट टेंशनिंग इज. वी प्री क्रिएट स्ट्रेसेस बिफोर utilizing the structural element and which gives us flexibility in terms of increasing the span. The rib floors are usually cast against metal or reinforced plastic formers in the form of preformed molds. Okay, this again we will be seeing it further. The molds you all know which come in standard sizes, which again depend on the contractor which is providing you this service. So generally these dimensions are 1 meter by 1 meter or what is it? The molds which are there, which are pre-existing. Of course we can customize it, but it is going to increase the cost of our project anyway. So they are typically used in long span construction like commercial premises, parking lots, etc. Of course, because if we consider a spaces like let's say residential or you know, so there we divide the spaces as per the rooms or the activity which is going to happen. So there we don't of course we won't prefer it to use a lesser depth which throughout is going to happen due to ribs which are going to come in between. Okay, so that's why generally for commercial premises, parkings and etc., where we need larger spans, we use this. Okay, advantages which of a span which we can achieve up to 9 meters with an effective depth of 500 to 600 mm. Okay, and if we go by conventional method, so for that we might have to go with the beam size of 800 mm or so if we are going to span 9 meters. Also it is going to increase the slab depth as well. So like it, we are using extra concrete for slab itself as well as bigger larger beams. So this is one of the, I mean, it can be an advantage for some projects, some activities, and it can be it can be a problem for some projects as well. So it depends how you use it. Reinforced usage, reinforcement usage is reduced by use of thinner diameter bar. So in this ribbed slab, generally the slab thickness is lesser. So again, since we are providing the proper reinforcement in every ribs, so the even the diameter, the cross section area of steel which we are going to use, that also reduces, which again affects the cost of the building. Use of molds for formwork ensures repetition of casting at steady pace, and service can be lined between the ribs. Yeah. And disadvantages, it has low fire rating. Customized molds for formwork needs to be fabricated. Yeah, again, as I said, if you are creating a multi-story building where you are going to use multiple slabs of the same same configuration, then it can be it can be helpful. Otherwise it can be complicated and expensive. There is uniform loss of depth as against peripheral intermittent loss and conventional slabs. So as I said, if we consider a space like parking or warehouses or large urban spaces, there the slab thickness which we want, it is throughout less. So if we create this slab, throughout the slab thickness is going to get increased, volumetrically speaking, if we say. Okay, 500 to 600 mm ka throughout the space you won't be able to use. So in terms of, let's say, halls or residential projects, there we can hide the beams with the walls or the visual barriers which are going to come at the periphery. So there we don't mind using bigger beams or larger beams, because at the center we need higher heights, okay, larger heights. So this uniformly, that volume space will be deducted if we use this kind of slab. Services like AC ducts, sprinklers cannot be passed perpendicular to the ribs easily. So here again, services, if it is pre-planned, good. If not, then later it is very difficult to include all these services by, and of course we can't, once the slab is cast in, then we can't create voids in between. Because the steel is running all across, reinforcement is running all across. We can't just cut it in between. People do practice it, but it's very bad practice. It shouldn't be done. It eventually reduces the strength of your member, which again eventually reduces the strength of your building. So unless it is pre-planned properly, if not, then we have to give this surface below the waffle slab, this ribbed slab. So the depth is again getting reduced. Okay, so yeah, that should be kept in mind. Components. So here it is a typical sketch of one-way spanning ribbed or trough roof, trough floor. So many of you might have seen this same configuration for the rough foundation as well, but inward. Okay, inverted. So to sustain the soil pressure which is going to come. So here if you can see my cursor, I don't know. So here the span, as I say, as we discussed, it can be 4.529. Here as you can see, the main beams which are running, wide flat beams which are supporting the ribs, they are thicker. So but still the depth is kept less and matched with the ribs, so you don't get it in between the in the space below. Ribs can be placed at center to center 600, 900, 1200, or sometimes even based on the design as well as the module formwork which we get. Okay, they can be it. We get it for 800 by 800 center to center or 1000 center to center. So we have to keep in mind what our standard practices. And if you want to go with that, or if you want to customize the dimension, then how it is going to affect. Okay, trough column. Yeah, depth of the rib more than rib, not more than 4x width. So let's say the depth of the width of the rib is going to be starts from 125 to let's say 200, not more than that. So the depth cannot be into four times. Like if we are considering 200 width of that rib, so the depth can't go beyond say 800 or so. Okay, so generally when we take 125, the height the depth can be 500 of, okay, it cannot go beyond it, otherwise the configuration changes and again you are creating the beam, thicker beam, and it won't serve the purpose of using this slab. Okay, the slab minimum thickness 75. Yeah, 75 to maximum we can go for 125 or so, not more than that. Okay, because we have provided ribs at proper intervals, so the slab thickness we don't want it to be extended. And again, 75 mm thickness is minimum required for two reasons. One being, of course, the slab is also going to have reinforcement in it, so it needs proper cover depth on both the sides. And second thing, we have to, when we are creating building, we have to follow some fire, we have to follow a few bylaws and firefighting rules. So like for 2 hour fire rating, to achieve that fire rating, we have to give that much depth. We cannot go lesser than that. So those are the two reasons. So design of one-way rib slab. Now, how will you decide what kind of slab you are going to have, and if rib one-way rib slab, then how will you be deciding the sizes of all the elements? Okay, so the first being, of course, it can span up to 9 meters. So if it is going beyond that, you have to change the type of slab and go for some other options. Okay, if you have been given span of 5 by 5 meter or 4 by 4 meter, then regular slab will also work. But again, that being which way, one way or two way or what, so you have to understand the condition given to you then each rib is minimum thickness of 125 mm at the soffit and is placed at 6 end. Achha, again, some ribs you might have seen, they are flared, okay, like they are wide at the top and narrowed down at the bottom. So again, that can also happen, the flat beams can also happen. So you have to see, again, the flared beam resists the shear force which is going to be acted due to the slab. Okay, so since we are expanding the top, it behaves like a, like in column also, when in flat slabs also, we as you all know, we increase the topmost area to resist the punching shear. But same kind of concept, that's why the ribs can be flared at the top. Okay, so yeah, so minimum thickness at bottom, it will be at the soffit, at bottom it would be 125 mm, and it can be placed from 600 to 1200 center to center. Okay, slab ribs, okay, the slab which is going to come over it, as I said, the slab thickness would be 65 to 75, maybe maximum 100, we don't go beyond that, because if you see, by giving these ribs, you are basically reducing the size of slab. So we don't need thicker slab for that. At the periphery, the ribs transfer the load onto the wide beam, which in turn transfers load onto the column. Okay, on periphery, again, the major two beams, as you can see in the previous image also, these two beams, they transfer load onto the, so the ribs transfer the load on the wide beams. Again, generally, you know that whenever we provide beams, we the orientation of that rectangle is vertical, okay, because it resists the deflection in that way, in that orientation better. But here, since we want to, we don't want the depth to be coming into picture and keep the bottom space clear, we are going to match it with the ribs depth which is going to come, and we are going to work with that cross section. So the that's why the peripheral yeah, so that's basically how we will decide the depth of the beams, peripheral beams as well. And the ribs are flared at beams for greater shear resistance. Yeah, this I have discussed. Okay, so if we see the reinforcement for the same, here you can see this is the cross section at the some way midway, it has been shown. So here the 500 mm deep rib beam, the rib beam, the depth, when I say, it has to be calculated from the top of the slab to the bottom. Okay, the depth should be considered in that manner, and not just from the soffit of slab to the bottom of rib. Okay, so here they have given 150 mm thick slab, I don't know, but it is not required as much. Okay, 5 mm mesh, again, if we are not getting since the cross section is getting divided into the ribs and it is getting supported by them, here there might not be the requirement of the reinforcement bar as such. The mesh would have worked, that's why they have shown that, otherwise single bar can work. Okay, 6 mm thick links, okay, 12 mm main reinforcement. Main reinforcement, as you can see here in the sections, this is at the periphery where the wide beam, as you can see, it is flattened a bit and the depth is matched with the ribs which are going to be there. And again, in between also, here they haven't showed any reinforcement, but if required, we will show it. Okay, if it is going to be here, it is ending at this edge, but if it is continuing on the left hand side, then again the reinforcement might change. Okay, shattering, again, this is an important part when we are doing the ribbed slabs. Okay, how the again the what we say proper process of construction is mentioned in further slide, but here I'm just showing you. So the molds which are provided, how they are placed initially, then they are fixed at that particular location, then the checking happens if it is at proper levels or not, and will they be able to carry the load of concrete and stay in position, then we go further. Then the reinforcement is placed, then the slab cover spacer blocks, of course, and then we pour concrete. Okay. So this is one way ripped slab. I hope you all refreshed your memory and collected. Still, if you have any doubts or anything, you can ask me right now. We can discuss. Or should I go ahead? Huh? No, no, I have two-way rib slab.
Okay. I should just remind everybody that this is just but everybody should know that today is the last lecture with regards to the syllabus. With regards to the syllabus that is meant for your sixth semester exam, university exam. Today is the last lecture by way of revision that we are doing. Some people may be thinking, why are we doing the same thing again? That's because of reason, because we've done this in the fifth semester, and all these advanced slabs and precast construction is syllabus of the sixth semester, which is set by university, which is set by faculty other than us. We outside people set the question paper. So we are just doing this, and you can as good as say by 15th of March, our syllabus was done with it. Beyond that, it only comes down to how you solve the papers. If you have any doubts, you can always ask us and things like that. Next class onwards, the construction class will only solve problems with regards to the IDS. Yeah. So now when we have started IDS, we gather that you all are facing. There you may need to know more about pile construction, pile foundation, pile construction. So we will take these things up. Those topics are only there for your better understanding to be able to attempt IDS. And today's class ends with the syllabus for the exam. So for the exam, we have not only covered the topic twice by way of a revision and earlier, and we've also covered the other topic other than these advanced slabs, that is the precast construction. This should be clear to everybody. Yeah, otherwise you must be thinking, why are we doing this unnecessary such that it remains on record that as part of sixth semester, these were the topics for construction which are going to come in the exam, and we have not only covered it in five, but we've also done a revision in six. From next time onwards, we shall be doing things that are beyond the syllabus only to aid you for your IDS. I'm just making this point clear so that you don't feel why are we unnecessarily repeating the topics, because beyond this, we may look forward to more relevant things that are associated with your IDS resolutions. Yeah, this is the kind of announcement that I had to make. Neeraj, you can continue. Thank you.
It would be required for such a large span. And because many of us just think it this, someone will tell us, because first thought when someone gives you a design problem, everyone's mind directly goes to ki yahan pe column slab aayega, wahan pe char beam periphery pe aayenge, and that's all. This never comes into mind initially if it is raised. So that's why understand the idea behind it, then the geometry, sizes and everything, they can be modified, they can be worked out, they can be researched. Okay. But yeah, so again, the two-way slab can span again in both the direction larger than the one-way rib system and the conventional system. The design of waffle slab is same as the previous one, but they are supported by columns where the support zones are made to be uniformly thick. So where the column is going to come. Okay, column and the main beam is going to come there. The size of the beam is going to be solid. The larger compared to the conventional system, but the spanning which happens in between is very huge, so it's fine to here construction technique. So again, the arrangement of framework which will be fixed by fixing of the connectors, fixing the framework. Okay, so arrangement is very important. Even the level difference, if something happens, koi upar niche bhi ho gaya, then it can create a problem at the end. So that's why all the measures, all the preparations is done properly to level and arrange the framework. Then fixing the connectors, fixing the framework, providing a horizontal connector, since it is going to be a waffle slab. Horizontal connector, again, it will be spaced as per the pods which we are going to use, the size of pods, I mean the ribs which are going to have, which we are going to have, the distance center to center jo aega, accordingly we place this domes or pods. Okay, then we remove the framework, remove the connectors once they are in place, and then remove the pods and provide stack. Okay, and then we cast this whole slab. So that's just the basic. Again, same method goes for the rib slab as well, or the diagrid slab. Okay, same procedure, but this I have practically experienced. The level was off by 5 centimeters or so at the other end. Okay, so that if it is not on site, if engineer or an architect is not present, it can go haywire and can change all your stress points of slabs, and it can affect your structure. So please, this it is not just the design which architect has to observe, but also these kind of works as well, later as you go ahead, if it is done correctly or not, technicality of it. So here again, as you can see, all the components, and here you can see the reinforcement which is laid across in both the directions, keeping the space in between for the pods, the molds. Okay, here it is the primary beam. Again, it is flared at the top to support the slab and not to have cracks due to the shear force. Here you might observe that the void has not been kept, because it is coming at the junction where the column is going to be there, and the both the beams in T direction, they're connecting. That's why this portion, this square portion, they have kept it solid. Two-way reinforcement. Yeah, since it is again kind of a two-way slab, we have we have ribs on in both the directions, so we can go beyond the conventional dimensions in both the directions. So it is it will have two-way reinforcement for the floors. Then glass fiber reinforced plastic molds. Okay, yeah, nail to glue. Okay, centering. They are placed properly without having struck by compressed air through holes in the top. Okay, yeah, the molds have holes to remove the excess air, so that the while pouring concrete, it shouldn't happen. That's right. Okay. So again, this so the services which are coming in the waffle slab, as I said, we have to plan it, pre-planned it. All these voids, all these cutouts are pre-planned, especially the AC ducts, which are mastika, and lighting wires and firefighting. These three services has to be planned. Plumbing pipes as well. Then insulation material for the can be provided within the depth of the waffle slab by providing holes in the waffle bottom surface. This system is also known as Polartec. Okay, if this is not happened, then many people do cut in between and everything, but that shouldn't be done. That will eventually give away your slab, so just keep that in mind. We can see the section. We have to understand how much we can span or we can go with this kind of slab. Again, see, base size is going to remain same, maybe a bit more with like 600 by 600 center to center for the ribs, or maybe 1000, or we can go till 1500. Okay, the void which is going to be there in between. So yeah, the construction system has the advantage of allowing much larger spans and lighter concrete slabs, and also due to its appearance, waffle slabs allow for several architectural and aesthetic opportunities with it. Okay. Yeah, the slab depth, again, it can vary from 75 to 125, same as what we saw in the rib slab. The rib width, it can go till 200 again, 125 to 200, and the overall depth of floor can vary from 300 to 600. Okay, with overall span, it can go up to 15 meters if reinforced, and even a bit longer if it is post tension. Okay. So, as we can see how the span is increasing by changing the geometry of the slab and increasing the ribs in both the direction. Okay, here you can see the typical section. This section is at the junction, the bottom section, as you can see, it is at the column beam junction, as we saw here. Okay. This void is kept as is sometimes, or it is, but the reinforcement runs across to make it solidify and not to have shear force acting over it. Okay. This is again same. The arrangement will be the same, but it will come in both the directions, so it can create a waffle slab. So advantages, again, longer span, saving on weight and material, of course. Vertical penetration between ribs are easily achieved. For an advanced construction technique, the speed of construction is relatively fast compared to others. Okay, for that particular, like for to achieve that much of a span. Good for sometimes service integration. Again, this will depend. If it is planned properly, then you don't have to hide it. It will automatically get hidden within the voids which are getting created. So you won't be even the AC unit, okay, which is going to come below the slab, generally which comes below the slab, it can be hidden within the one of the void for those waffles. Okay. Disadvantage, requires special foam work. Yeah, as we know, the design is going to be different, or the module is going to be different, it can be difficult. And generally, due to overall slab and beam depth, a greater floor to floor height is required to allow the waffle slabs. So generally, when we say, when we look like we, when we do a, when we do a design problem, we know that clear height is, let's say, 3 meters, 4 meters, 5 meters, but when we use this kind of slabs, then the slab depth is increased, like from generally we consider it 125 to 150 mm, it gets increased to 400 or so. The overall volume will reduce for the usage of floor area below. Okay, so that has to be kept in mind, but still the span which we can achieve, we can of course increase the floor height to resolve this problem. And these are again just few modifications which are done to not to keep the typical design of waffles. Here, as you can see, the mold have been modified to have particular shapes. Here again, they have cast it in a way so that they can get the skylight in. Here, cutouts in beams to accommodate service. Here, they have provided the cutouts everywhere, pre-planned kiya hua, so they don't have to worry about later changing or modifying any services. Okay, so yeah, this is pretty much it. Do you guys have any questions, any queries, any suggestions, any comments? Do unmute yourself and talk. I don't mind.
Are there any queries? Please understand. I should be very specific in telling you. that understanding the details and understanding the principle is one part to it. But like I shared the question paper last time, I hope you should all understand that there is a problem that is given on the basis of which you need to be able to apply the right kind of structural system for the base sizes or for the problem that is given to you. Sometimes it's an institutional building that is given. Sometimes it's a commercial building that is given. Sometimes it's a residential building that is given. Based on the building type, it is expected that you apply either flat or ribbed or waffle or diagrid as per the understanding and as per the base sizes that is there. Now that none of us can teach you. That can come only through reasoning. That can come on through the reasoning of the base that of the tech of the base that it can cover and the kind of spans it can cover that is there. Like last time I gave you the problem, I could have solved that building in all three types. I could have solved last time that I gave you the base, I shared the question paper for the advanced slab. That floor plate could have been designed by all three types. It could be designed with flat, it could have been designed with waffle, and it could have been designed with ribbed. But with all three types, the column positions and the spans would have been different. In flat slab, perhaps the column distances would have been more squarish and it could have been up to distances of 9.9 meters. And I would have allowed the slab to protrude out by way of a cantilever, by way of the beam strip that can afford to cantilever out. Yeah. In ribbed, the base, in one direction, the base would be smaller. In the other direction, the base would be larger. In a waffle slab, perhaps you would have square base, but larger in both the direction. Yeah. And similarly is the kind of understanding. You would have only peripheral columns in the case of a diagrid slab. So what I'm trying to tell you, for any span that is there, for any kind of floor plate that may be given to you, perhaps you may be able to apply all three, all four types. But if you should know how the design of the slab system takes place. If you just put columns like the way we are seeing columns as of now in the IDS, I see everybody is putting columns in a square bay. Whatsoever reason is there, columns are there in a square bay. And if that's the understanding you put in a construction paper, I think the examiners of my age and order immediately gather that the student doesn't know and they immediately mark it as a wrong. So putting square columns means it may indicate that you want to work with a flat slab. But then when we talk, people have no clarity about the dimensions of the flat slab bay, strip base, slab base, none of that. People are talking about ribbed, but they do not know that a ribbed slab is always applied to a rectangular bay where columns in the shorter direction, there are columns in the shorter direction and the longer direction is three times the size of the shorter direction. Yeah, so you have 4 by 12 or 4 by 10 or 5 by 12, those kind of bays in rib, whereas waffle is completely different. So how to up? Maximum we can cover the principles, maximum we can talk about the details. But how one should go about applying, that can only happen when you look at the question papers and you attempt it yourself. And should you have any query, you can always get in touch with me or Neeraj and we can always help you out by saying that this can be solved by this, but then the base will be designed in this manner. That can be solved by that. And so make sure whenever you get an opportunity to the question papers are available with your seniors since they've given exams. I think you have a good rapport with your seniors. Ask them to pass on the soft or hard copies of the paper to you whenever you get the opportunity to have a look at it. If not, I'm sure you all are clever enough to manage. Yeah. So are there any doubts? As I told you earlier, with this, we have wound up with with what you need to prepare for the exam. Now, from next time onwards, Neeraj will help you all understand. Yeah, Neeraj, you think you should be able to manage for next time?
Yeah.
Types of piles.
file
types of piles. Yeah, all three types of piles. That is the traditional wooden pile, then the in situ pile and the precast pile.
Yes. Hmm?
In precast, both steel as well as concrete. And then how pile caps sit on piles. Arrangements of two piles, three piles, four piles. So we will look at how the foundation, how the cross section of the foundation changes, how plinth beams come and connect to pile caps, and how below pile caps we have a conglomeration of piles. Never is a pile in isolation. The piles are always in the combination of two, three, or four. So, and then what are the kind of distances you leave in between the piles, and how is the design of the pile cap that takes place? These are some details Neeraj will share with us next time, such that for your IDS, your foundation drawings can start falling in place. By that time, get your columns in position, get your center lines in position. Yeah, there is time for the foundation drawing to come up. I'm sure by next Tuesday, your understanding on the types of piles and the kind of pile caps and their spacings will more or less be clear. Anything else? Would anybody like to ask anything or comment on anything particular? I hope I don't have to remind you that there is 1 week. This is the week starting yesterday. This is the 1 week for people who are defaulting in last semester IDS. They are supposed to make sure that they show their work to the respective faculty. Just by submitting work at the end is not going to help you. People don't get KTs for submitting work, just resubmitting work. People who get KT are supposed to work show minimum twice or thrice such that their work can upgrade qualitatively. Yeah, qualitatively, before they resubmit again for upgradation. So this is 1 week's time that you have, both for semester five. I think semester five design already people have submitted. Now for design semester, for IDS semester five, those people who have not made the mark, make sure you interact with whoever you think you can get along with, such that when they look at your work, they can suggest changes and they can vouch for your work. People can vouch, faculty can vouch for someone's work that yes, I have seen his work. His quality of work has improved drastically, and now he or she needs to pass. Make sure you do that such that there are no difficulty. Please do remember, if you don't clear fifth semester internal marks, you cannot give semester six exam. Yeah, it will be a big waste. Semester six exam is just around the corner. Yeah, you never know when the 8 weeks of the IDS will be done with. By May end will be the exam. You will have no time to then look up at semester five. The fallback of not clearing semester five is very grave, as you will not get admission in semester seven either. So neither will you be able to give exam and neither will you be able to take admission in semester seven. So not clearing semester five is a very, very, has a very big fallback. You'll lose a year. You'll have to take a drop and not be able to take admission in seventh semester for not clearing fifth semester internal marks. I'm repeating this because the implications are very grave. You may be thinking, why am I trying to just remind you of all this and why am I talking about these things? But for people who have not cleared semester five, the implication is very clearly that there is a possibility, if you don't clear now, there's a possibility you may lose a year. You may not be able to take admission in semester seven. So, and nobody is going to follow up. Your KT is your baby, your responsibility to follow up and get itself cleared. Yeah. So I think I'm done with it. We are as good as 12:20. I have downloaded the attendance. Thank you, Neeraj. And yeah, we look forward to next time for better understanding for IDS. We will take as many smaller topics from next time onwards that can help in your IDS resolution. No more will we be talking about anything related to the syllabus because we've done with it. I think it's your own responsibility to see whether we've And I think we have covered the syllabus. We've also done a revision. So it's done with it. Now it only comes down to you solving papers to see whether your understanding is good enough or not. If there are any doubts, feel free to always post messages and we should be more than happy to help. Yeah. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Yes.
Jimmy, I'm confused in the design of the file cap. Like, अभी वो जो कॉलम होगा मतलब जो सर्कुलर कॉलम होगा उसका मतलब अगर मैंने चार कॉलम रखे तो उन दोनों उन चारों का स्पैन कितना तक लिमिटेड हो सकता है. लाइक अभी मल्टीपर्पज हॉल जो है मेरा वो पूरा 750 स्क्वायर मीटर तक है तो आई एम जस्ट आस्किंग अगर अंदर मैंने कॉलम्स रखे तो कितना स्पैन लिमिटेड हो सकता है दोनों चारों में. आई
एम नॉट अंडरस्टैंडिंग योर क्वेश्चन रोहित.
जो फाइल कैप है मतलब फाइल कैप रीइंफोर्समेंट जो है अभी वो जो डिजाइन वो पूरा कॉलम का ही है.
कॉलम के नीचे एक 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 फाइल कैप एक चीज है जो फाइल कैप कहते हैं. वो फाइल कैप इज अ कनेक्शन बिटवीन द स्मॉलर पाइल्स बिलो एंड योर कॉलम अबव. देख आपके कॉलम के आपका कॉलम को जो भी साइज का है उसके नीचे छोटे छोटे पाइल्स रहेंगे पतले पाइल्स रहेंगे. बट नेचुरली द कनेक्शन बिटवीन योर कॉलम एंड द पाइल्स इज नॉट पॉसिबल डायरेक्टली. तो पाइल कैप ऐसी चीज है एक कैप है बराबर एक टोपी जैसी है टोपी. हाँ वो पाइल कैप जो है आपका कॉलम और पाइल्स को कनेक्ट करता है. तो दिखाएंगे आपको नेक्स्ट टाइम. क्या टेंशन क्यों ले रहे हो तुम इमीजिएटली कुछ तुम्हें पाइल कैप नहीं देना है. और अगर तुम्हें जरा भी ये है देखना है तो तुम जरा भी इंटरनेट पे पाइल कैप टाइप करोगे तो आपको 500 स्केचेस देखने को मिलेंगे कि पाइल कैप कैसे दिखता है. पर हम भी कवर करेंगे. सो पाइल कैप इज लाइक अ बिग कैप दैट सिट्स ऑन 3 or 4 पाइल्स एंड अलाउज द कॉलम टू कम एंड सिट ऑन टॉप ऑफ इट. दैट्स इट. इट्स अ कनेक्टर. बेसिकली इट्स अ कनेक्टर बिटवीन पाइल्स एंड योर कॉलम. एंड दिस पाइल कैप is designed at a position where your in plinth beams can come and connect to all the pile caps. So at the foundation level, you can have plinth beams that are connecting all the pile caps such that all the piles and pile caps can be in one level without going up and down. And the pile cap allows the column to come and sit properly and distribute the entire load of the columns amongst all the piles evenly distributed. Now what with regards to your span and hall and all that I don't understand. वो क्या है that I'm not understanding.
मुझे पाइल कैप पहले समझाने अभी like अभी समझ next time समझ.
आप जरा Google पे सर्च करो पाइल कैप. देखो आपको 500 इमेजेस मिलेंगे कि पाइल कैप कैसे दिखता है. एक कंक्रीट का पैड जैसा रहता है जो पाइल्स के ऊपर बैठा है बस. लेकिन उसका रिइंफोर्समेंट कैसा है वो पाइल कैप्स के साथ कैसे मर्ज होता है वो कॉलम्स के साथ कैसे मर्ज होता है रिइंफोर्समेंट वाइज वो हम नेक्स्ट टाइम आपको कवर करके दिखाएंगे. नहीं तो कुछ नहीं है एक पैड जैसा है. पाइल्स के ऊपर एक पैड है जो कॉलम को बैठने को मदद करता है.